Minnesota nurse Jennifer Nibby made a frantic 911 call in the early morning hours of August 31, 2010. According to police records, she reported that an unidentified male entered her home and murdered her husband, Jim. There had been prior reports in the community of shadowy figures holding flashlights and trespassing on neighbors' backyards. In addition, Jim recently bought a gun for her to use as protection and insisted she learn how to use it. As officers descended upon the area and detectives began to process the crime scene, a pressing question loomed large. Was a murderous predator still lurking nearby, ready to strike once more? Let's dive in. Jennifer and James Nibby shared a home with her 16-year-old son in Blue Earth County, Minnesota. They had no children in common. Born and raised in Mankato, 26-year-old James, also known as Jim, graduated from Minnesota West Community and Technical College in 2002. He then began working with Maple River Electric as an apprentice electrician. Jim was an avid hunter who was also passionate about golf and do-it-yourself projects. He hailed from a large, loving family with strong roots in Blue Earth County. Jennifer was also born and raised in Minnesota. She enjoyed popularity throughout high school due to her physical attractiveness and charm. She became pregnant at 16 while in high school and was able to raise her son with her family's support. After graduation, she went on to obtain a nursing degree in 1999. Friends and family members described Jennifer as strong-willed and determined. She eventually accepted a full-time nursing position at Mankato Surgery Center and achieved her goal of purchasing a house in the rural city of Lake Crystal. Jim and Jennifer tied the knot on May 24, 2008. With their union, they formed a harmonious blended family. To the outside world, they seemed like any other American family. However, everything changed on August 31, 2010, when a horrifying incident compelled Jennifer to call 911.
Blue Earth County 911.
Oh my God, please help us. Please help us. Somebody trying to kill us.
What's going on?
Somebody shot
your husband?
Please send the ambulance.
Okay, is the person still there that shot him?
I don't know. He left.
Is there anybody else in the house with you?
My son is not still. Oh my God, my son is still.
How old is your son?
He's not. I'm 16.
16-year-old?
Oh my God, I'm
not. Where in the house are you right now?
I'm in the basement right now.
Okay, is your son in the basement with you too?
Yeah, my son is in my basement too.
Are you okay?
I'm okay. He shot me when I don't
know. Shot you?
No, don't stop it.
Freak out.
No, you can't. I knew it. He left.
Officers arrived quickly and secured the scene. Jennifer explained to officers she was in the bathroom when she heard a gunshot. Next, she rushed to their bedroom to find Jim had been shot as he lay in bed. She then encountered an intruder wearing dark clothing and nylon over his face. She stated that the intruder placed a rope around her neck, threatened her with a knife, and dragged her to the living room before fleeing. When the dust settled, she realized Jim had been shot and killed with his own rifle. Jennifer showed the officers some bruises on her neck and cuts on her thigh as proof of her struggle against the assailant. She also claimed that the attacker told her, "You're lucky you're not dead." Upon inspecting the crime scene, it did not take long for detectives to notice things were not adding up. No signs of forced entry were observed. Police officers searched the premises, a farm on a gravel road in a rural area, but found no footprints or tire tracks inside or outside the home, even though it had been raining that day. Nothing inside the house seemed out of place, and there were no clear indicators that any struggle had occurred. Although numerous pieces of physical evidence, including many fingerprints, were collected from the home, analysis by the Bureau of Criminal Apprehension couldn't identify a suspect. A preliminary autopsy concluded that Jim died of a single gunshot wound. Investigators decided to dig deeper into the Nibbies' marriage. They soon found a spiral notebook in which Jennifer had been keeping detailed notes. In an entry dated August 1st, Jennifer wrote the following. Well, I'm working at the nursing home again, trying to save money for property taxes and for my son's college expenses that will be coming up. I thought he would be able to help me more, but he's fishing this weekend. Doesn't have money to contribute more to the household finances. A second journal entry states, I know I still love him. He tells me he still loves me. How can that be? It's not supposed to work this way. This is not how I wanted my life to turn out. I'm married to one man that I care about, but in love with another man who has a girlfriend, a baby on the way, but still tells me he loves me. I could scream. Sometimes I wish I could go back to just my son and I. Cell phone analysis revealed that for several months before her husband's death, Jennifer had been exchanging sexually explicit text messages with another man. Additionally, investigators discovered that she had recently taken out a life insurance policy of $250,000 on Jim, and that Jennifer had been purchasing vast amounts of prescription pain medication, which had become a financial burden. Friends and family members acknowledged that Jim and Jennifer had marital challenges, primarily centered around Jim's limited income and Jennifer's fatigue from working double shifts to cover the bills. Using the gathered evidence, authorities obtained an arrest warrant for Jennifer Nibby on suspicion of murder. She was apprehended in her workplace parking lot on September 10th, 10 days after Jim's death. At first, Jennifer declined to talk to the detectives, but after spending one night in jail, she changed her mind and asked to meet with them. Sensing Jennifer's increasing anxiety and her potential need to unburden herself, the detectives aimed to create an environment encouraging open dialogue. They tried to appear genuine and supportive at all times, aiming to elicit a confession using the Reed Technique's alternative question method. This method offers two scenarios of what might have occurred, one being more socially acceptable than the other. While the suspect is likely to pick the lesser incriminating option, both choices imply an admission of guilt.
Brady had this business. It was the day before the wake. We ended up having this crap too.
How long did it last? A little while?
It was a good 3-4 days. He had a fever and stuff too. So, just a couple questions. Can I ask some questions or no?
You can, but what we have to clarify a couple things, Jen, just for the record, is that you initiated and told the jail that you wanted to talk to us.
Yes.
So that's why we came in here.
Yes.
And met with you. And then the other thing is, for us to talk to you at all, we have to read your rights because you're in custody.
Sure.
Now. So I do have to do that again.
Okay.
And if there's a question you don't want to answer or something like that, you never have to. That's maybe I haven't made that clear before, but I do have to go through that again, okay?
Fine.
All right. You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can all be used against you in court. You have the right to talk to a lawyer now or have a lawyer present now or any time during questioning. If you cannot afford to hire a lawyer, one will be appointed for you without cost.
Okay.
Do you understand each of these rights I've explained to you?
I do.
And having them in mind, are you willing to speak with us at this time?
Yes.
Okay.
For one thing for Monday is because the lawyer that I wanted to get, and as I'm thinking about things and things are going through my mind, if I decide not to hire this lawyer, you said, is one going to be appointed for me on
sure.
Monday then? Is that how that works?
Right. If you decided not to hire a lawyer that you've already talked to,
mm-hmm.
you can tell the court, you can either tell the court, I have this lawyer, or I have that lawyer, or I'm going to call a lawyer, or I'd like you to appoint me a lawyer, whichever. You just need to tell the court
okay.
What your intentions are.
Okay. You said homicide yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
What are my convictions?
You're not convicted of anything yet. You're charged.
Okay, what am I charged
with? Charged
I never had a charge sheet or a charge.
The jail had a copy of it.
They have a copy of it over there.
Oh.
Maybe, did you ask them to see it or anything? Or
I didn't, I guess.
Okay.
We can make that happen too. We go
right,
back
but I can tell you it's second degree
okay.
Murder is what you're charged with.
Okay.
That's you know.
And what does that entail?
I think it's second degree intentional murder is what you're charged with. So that
mm-hmm.
just means that you intended to kill somebody.
Mm-hmm.
If you accidentally shoot somebody, that's generally charged as manslaughter, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like if you're being careless with a gun, doing something crazy and it goes off, you know, a lot of times you'll see guys think a gun's unloaded and they point it and pull the trigger and it's not. That's oftentimes charged like as a manslaughter because
mm-hmm.
it was an accident, but you were still doing something that you really shouldn't have been doing,
right.
you know.
Right.
Then you'd be charged with manslaughter. Then the next step up from that is second degree murder. So, So that's the situation.
I don't know what to say.
I know.
I know it's not going to.
But I think sometimes it's what we're talking to you about without us knowing what exactly happened.
Like I said, I mean, we know about the drug stuff, John. Okay? If you're out of your mind on drugs, you're out of your mind on drugs. That's okay, but we need to know that and hear it from you, I guess, is the only thing, you know?
I have an addiction to prescription pain pills.
Okay. When did it start?
I'm so ashamed.
It's okay.
I call prescriptions in for myself. I'm just so ashamed.
It's okay.
A lot of people have things happen. A lot of people make mistakes. You're not the only person that's ever been addicted to prescription pain medication.
Was there an event that kind of started that off, that precipitated that? Did you get injured or something, or just?
I injured my ankle a while ago, and it got worse after. While we were dating that first year, it wasn't too bad, and then it was slightly before I think we got married that I ended up becoming addicted to them and needing to have them all the time, otherwise I would go through withdrawal.
Okay. What did it start with tramadol or start with something else?
No, it's just always been tramadol.
Because that's not a commonly prescribed drug, is it?
It's not even a controlled substance.
Okay.
It's not even a controlled narcotic, but it has opioid effect.
Okay. So it kind of affects your brain in the same way a narcotic would.
Yep.
Okay. And how much, I mean, what? How much are you using right now? How much had you been using on average?
180 pills a week.
Oh.
Which is usually 8 per day is the max.
Okay. And those are what, how many milligram, like 40 milligram?
50.
50 milligram pills. Wow.
I just, my life wasn't, this is how we're supposed to go.
Well, and it sounds like from some of the stuff we're hearing, you, for a while, you've been kind of carrying all the bills and that kind of stuff. So you've been under, you know, a lot of pressure to work 2 jobs, 3 jobs.
Yeah.
I'm sure that doesn't help.
I never wanted to hurt anybody. But I am an honest person. I'm not a liar. And I've always taught that to my son. But I've become that person, I've become that liar that finding excuses why I'd be late for work and stuff, and a lot of it was the meds. A lot of it was the using. And I knew I worked in healthcare and knew you could get help, but I didn't do it.
A lot of people have to battle through stuff too, John. Like I said, it's nothing that anybody wants to talk about too, but you're not the only person that's had to go through through that stuff. And it has effects on people where they do stuff that they wouldn't normally do. It changes them, you know? It really does. We see it all the time. And prescription drug stuff is getting to be bigger than anything else, so it's a lot of people that have problems with it.
I can't
can't face anybody. How do you face somebody when you've done something like this?
I know.
It was like I was there, but I wasn't.
Like you were not in your person watching yourself do something and...
Oh, it was the devil. Get rid of it.
Was there voices telling you that? Did you feel like you were hallucinating?
I don't know.
You hadn't slept all night, had you? I could tell that morning you looked like you'd been up for hours and hours. You've been taking way too many pills?
Yeah.
Do you ever...
Way too many.
Do you ever crush them up? Are you ingesting them any other way than...
All right, I have some hair or something in
okay.
my mouth. I usually just took them as pills.
Okay.
No, I didn't. I never injected or anything like
okay.
that.
Okay.
Is it kind of a secret you were keeping too, or did other people know about it much?
Nobody knew about it.
Getting harder to keep that secret, or?
Well, financially wise, I suppose it was.
Because
I had to pay for those. And, you know, it wasn't cheap, but I also had to pay for everything else, so.
Yeah, it seemed like they said, from what we're hearing, Jim hadn't been working much up until recently.
Up until these last 4 months, I suppose.
So you were carrying the mortgage and the bills and... They say working 3 jobs, it's a lot of pressure.
I don't understand how somebody goes from this to this, just like that. I don't get it.
I know. You know what, Jen? I want to tell you just about my friend, my best friend in the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
We've been friends for many years, worked together, you know, do stuff outside of work together.
I know you can lie to me, though. Is this bullshit?
No, it is not bullshit.
Okay, but I'm
it's
sorry, you guys.
No, listen.
I'm not stupid either.
No, I know you're not
so.
Stupid. Jen, I absolutely know you're not stupid, okay? We've talked to a ton of people, and we've talked to you, and I know you're not stupid, and I do not think you're stupid, and neither does Paul.
We've spent a lot of time talking together, and
We don't think you're stupid. This is a true story, and I'm just telling this because I want you to understand that we're not these evil people who just think terribly of you, okay? But I had a good friend. We were very close for 12 years. Partners at work, not outside of work. We were like this. Okay, we're kind of like you and Carrie. You know what I mean? We're tight. And he had hurt his back and then he hurt his knee, both on work related injuries. And he had gotten hooked on pain pills. He was taking oxycodone though. You know, but same effect on the brain probably. And I had no idea. And he had gotten addicted and he was doing the same types of things, internet pharmacies, taking all these pills, and. You know, it destroyed his life. It destroyed our friendship. He ended up losing his job. I mean, and he was out of his mind, and he was doing crazy, crazy things. And this was my best friend. And I'm like, this can't be. This can't be happening. I don't want to believe it, but it does happen because it controls you.
Mm-hmm.
And this is not a BS story. I swear to you, it's a true story. So I can't relate personally like I can say I've been in your shoes, but I've seen it before. Okay, I've seen it before up close, and it's very powerful. And like I've said before, it makes people do things that they wouldn't do in a million years. You know, and we can't, none of us can go back and undo what's happened. Okay? As much as you want to, okay, I know you want to, but we can't.
God, if I could give my life, I would.
What?
If I could give him my life, I would.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. You said something, Jen, that we can lie to you, and you know, we, to a degree, police can, but I'm not going to. I'm not going to lie to you. Okay, I promise. You have my word. I'm not. I hope you can look at me in the eyes and believe that I'm not going to lie to you. Okay. We don't want to do that. We don't need to do that. You said yourself, you've always been an honest person, and that, again, all the people we've talked to, your friends, your family, all of them say the same thing, okay? You are of good character, okay? You have no criminal record, you have worked hard to make something of yourself, and you've worked very hard to make something of Brady, and he is a great kid.
Good kid.
He is number one in his class.
He is a good kid. Oh,
yeah.
God, he's a good kid. This is going to kill him.
Well... No, Brady can survive this, okay? He can survive this. Okay, it's gonna be hard. Okay.
Nobody's gonna ever forgive me. I guess I can't blame them.
So sometimes they will, though.
I don't know that I would say that. I don't say that would necessarily be the case.
So if I plead guilty on Monday, what is going to happen to me?
That I can't tell you that. And again, I told you I won't lie. I don't know, okay? All those decisions, our job, Paul's job, my job, we're not here to judge you, okay?
I know.
It's only our job to gather the facts, to find the truth, and present that to the prosecuting attorney. They make the decision on charges. You know, the judge has input on, you know, all those things, on sentence, and that's all, you know, that's all stuff we're getting, you know, the cart kind of ahead of the horse here, you know. But, you know, what I can tell you, that the only thing we can do for you is try and present your story fairly and accurately. And that's what I've promised people before, is I won't twist things, okay? I won't. I won't try to portray you as something that you're not, okay? I'm not going to try to just put spin on it. You know what I mean? I can promise you, that's something I promise you, is that I can be, make sure that what is real and true and accurate goes forward. And if you present, I mean, I would never go to the court and say, oh, I think Jennifer has, you know, been a terrible mother and a terrible wife. I don't think those things at all. I think that, you know what I mean? You've done the right things. Okay. And I would be honest in that. Okay. You know, what would happen to you, you know, what potential sentences and those kinds of things, man, that's all for people above us. That's for prosecuting and attorneys to make on charging decisions and judges, you know. That's all beyond us. I can't make that up. That's just the way
it is. Are they going to make me reenact everything?
No, I don't. You know, for to enter a guilty plea, you have to give some statement of what mm-hmm. happened. For the court for the judge to be satisfied that it's believable and he accepts it and all those things, you know, because sometimes, crazy as it sounds, sometimes people who didn't do things sometimes do claim to have done something, and so the judge has to make sure that he believes, you know, that, but as far as actually reenacting things, no.
And I, too, a lot of, you know, what we do, too, is for courts and for our job for that, but a lot of what we do, too, is for people that are left behind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I personally would you know, if I empathize with the family too,
mm-hmm.
I'm sure that the county would want to know too, exactly.
Right.
You know,
right.
And
that's the biggest question right now, probably, that the people we talk to have, is they want to know how and why, you know,
mm-hmm.
they just want answers, you know, they want something that they can kind of wrap their mind around and, you know, say, well, okay, this is why this all happened.
And we kind of got a little bit of a window into things through our investigation, too, you know. But, again, you know, we weren't there, so.
There's just so many things going through my head, I don't know. I mean, it's everything we've talked about. The pressure of everything, the finances, and the drugs,
And you live here when you eat. You live your day for that next fix.
Mm-hmm. Jim didn't know anything about this either. You were able to keep it from him,
mm-hmm.
at least.
For the most part,
mm-hmm.
yeah. I would say it was my headache medicine or stomach medicine or...
Mm-hmm. And you know, your family and everybody has said, yeah, Jen's, we don't think she's well physically, you know. That's people have told us that. That's
yeah.
They've recognized that something's wrong. They don't know what,
yeah.
you know, but.
Like I said, it was me, but it wasn't me.
I know. Well, Jim, what's more important than you know, it happened, you can't back up and do it, obviously you're sorry. Okay, you said yourself if you could change it and give your life, you would. Is that true? You said that? That's what you meant?
Yeah.
Because there again, those are things that I think that's important for people to hear that from you. You know how you feel that you're not some uncaring. Okay.
It was horrible. It was horrible when it happened. I thought, oh my God, what did I do? What's wrong with me? And that's why I made it look like someone tried to hurt me and
okay.
came in.
Okay. I want to make sure on a couple things, though, that are important, okay? Brady had nothing to do with any of this.
No.
Swear.
I swear to God. No, I swear to
and
God.
He doesn't know
no.
anything about it. He didn't help you set
no.
the scene up
no.
or anything. You
oh,
truly,
God, no.
You truly didn't wake him up until
no.
afterwards?
I swear to God.
Okay.
I swear on my life.
Okay.
I swear.
Well, I know. I believe you if you swear that it's the truth.
I do.
But I have to ask you
yes.
that. I have to be clear on that.
I do. Brady
but,
had absolutely nothing to do with it. He was so startled.
Mm-hmm.
When I went down there, because I was on the phone with 911,
mm-hmm.
when I went down there to ask him, he was asleep. You know,
okay.
he was dead asleep, and I called his name twice. And then he finally woke up, you know, with the big eyes, like,
mm-hmm.
what the hell is going on, Mom?
Right.
You know?
So his reactions, which they seem like they're all very normal and appropriate
yeah.
for somebody in that situation,
yeah.
that's all legit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Brady knew nothing about it. Nothing.
Okay.
Nothing.
Did anybody know about it?
No. No.
Terry, nobody?
Nobody.
Okay.
Nobody.
Okay. I believe you. How long had you been thinking about it, though, that night? I mean, like you say, you were up all night.
I went to sleep at one point.
Okay.
Because we went to sleep, and I think by the time I actually fell asleep, though, it was like probably 12:30. And then I woke up at 4:30
okay.
to my alarm.
Okay.
And I shut that off. And I had fallen back asleep.
Okay.
And then when it was 5:30, that's when I all of a sudden got into a panic and went. Because I had taken some meds.
And you hadn't had much sleep.
So, oh, it just makes me sick even thinking about it.
I know.
And what I did.
I know. I'm sure it's been just killing you the last few days.
It's been killing me since the day it happened.
Mm.
I just can't live with this lie.
And that's the first step that you've taken now, Jen, is you're recognizing that you are still a person with good qualities, okay? And you're on the right track to try and still be that person. You know what I mean? This is not the end of Jen, okay? It's not. This is, you're gonna...
That's what it is.
Well, I know, but...
How can somebody do that? And I kept saying no, and it was like someone was telling me, he's the devil.
Telling you that Jim's the devil?
And I did it.
Mm-hmm. And then you thought, oh my God, what did I do?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for letting me bury him.
Okay.
Before arresting me, I appreciate that.
Okay, you're welcome. And you deserve to have that. You deserve to have that closure and your say goodbye. And just because you made a mistake doesn't mean you didn't care about him.
He was a good man. I need help, though.
And I know that this is really hard, and I don't want to push you, okay?
Okay.
I don't. I really don't. And I'm not going to, and Paul's not either, okay? Mm-hmm. This is you, and I'm going to write the report that way.
Okay.
That Jen did this of her own volition. We didn't make her do this. She is a big person, is a person of strong enough character, and said, I'm going to be honest and do this, okay? Because that's what happened, right?
Yes.
And I guarantee I will make the report reflect that, okay? That is the way this happened. And I'm not gonna push you. I know you're having a very hard time with this, okay? Which is completely understandable. But we do need to go through the details. Or we'd like to just one time, okay?
Okay.
And you do it, and we're not gonna push, and you do it at your own pace, okay? But I know you want to have the truth out there. Exactly the truth. Okay, from start to finish, one time.
I don't know where to start. I guess
let's start Monday night. Let's start Monday night. You're with Carrie, right? She was not doing well, not feeling well. Is that true?
Yep.
Okay. I thought it was.
Yes, that was very true. Oh. So we went back home. Oh, this is horrible.
I know.
It's horrible, though, you guys.
I know.
And yes, I had to. Jim, there was a gun Jim had bought for me.
That's true, too.
That's very true.
Okay.
Jim bought the gun for me, wanted me to learn how to target practice.
Mm-hmm.
Was
he, when you got home Monday night, was he already home or did you get home first?
He was home first and then I got home.
When you
he
got
was
there.
Outside dinking around. So I okay. said, you want to help? Or I said, do you want me to target shoot? Because you've been wanting me to target shoot. He bought me that gun.
Mm-hmm.
So we target shoot, or we did our target practice or whatever, went inside, got a little to eat. Brady
so
and I
so
had
you shot first.
Part. Yeah, I think we shot first.
Then went inside
to eat. Then went inside to eat.
Okay.
Yeah. And then... me and Brady had our little meatball fight.
Mm-hmm.
And so then I came back upstairs and had finished off the rest of the meatballs and the mashed potatoes, and Jim had been making some other leftovers and stuff for him. And then I put the dishes away, and I brushed my teeth, and then Jim and I went and sat on the couch and watched TV. And he had set the gun in the corner.
Where at? In which room?
In the, but next to the sliding glass door.
Okay.
He set that in the corner, and I knew the ammo was up there, too.
Okay.
Because we had put that there.
And he had showed you how to load the gun.
Mm-hmm.
How to, and can.
Yeah, because we went deer hunting the year before. I mean, mm-hmm. he was trying to teach me how to do all that with any type of gun that he was mm-hmm. giving me to use. So. Mm-hmm. And then we watched the news until 10:30 and went to bed. He was after me about sex a lot, and that was something that bothered me.
Okay, caused some friction between you two?
Yeah. He, wanted on a pretty regular basis, and I tried the best I could, but sometimes I just, sometimes I just had problems with that, and if he continue to push and push and push, it just ends up not being fun for the other person, you know?
Right.
So,
just be tension.
Mm-hmm. So there was resentment there, because it was a constant thing. A constant, you want to do it, you want to do it, you want it. Mm-hmm. And there was no romance left when it came to that. It was like, fine, just finish and get it over with so I can go to sleep, I guess. So,
mm-hmm.
So I actually had made something up that I had a yeast infection or something like that.
Okay. So he was...
Sorry, guys.
No, it's all right. And he was that night wanting to
yep.
have sex, and you didn't want
yep,
to.
Yeah, and I didn't want to.
Did it become a big fight, or was it just kind of a...
He usually just got mad and rolled over and went to bed. That's usually the way it would go.
Okay.
That happened every week.
Okay.
If not twice a week, he would get mad at me for... If he could have it every day, he could, but
mm-hmm.
I... Sometimes when you're approached in certain ways, it's just not fun anymore. So,
mm-hmm.
So I laid there and I laid there. I had taken some pills before I'd gone to bed.
Do you remember how many?
Probably like six or eight. Which sometimes when I do that, I have a hard time sleeping to begin with because that is how it messes with you sometimes.
It kind of like make you agitated?
It does. It kind of keeps you up, makes you dream, mm-hmm. stuff like that. And so I woke up, alarm went off at 4:30, and I had shut it off. And I think I had a couple more pills laying on the nightstand that I had taken. I'm trying to remember if I had water there, if I just took them dry. I don't even know. And I had fallen back asleep, though. And I woke up at 5:30 in a panic. And that's when I went out and I cut the gun. And I loaded one shell. And I came back into the bedroom. And there was a throw blanket laying on the end of the bed. So I took that and kind of rested the gun on this shoulder. And they just kept saying, "It's the devil, it's the devil." Yeah. And I pulled the trigger.
It's okay.
In March 2011, a Blue Earth County grand jury indicted Jennifer Nibby on one count of first-degree murder and one count of second-degree murder. In June 2012, Jennifer accepted a plea agreement by which she would plead guilty to the lesser charge, and the state would recommend a sentence of 25 and a half years in prison. The sentencing took place 1 month later. According to prison records, Jennifer will be parole eligible in August 2027, while her prison term will end in February 2036. In 2014, a settlement was reached between Jennifer Nibby and the heirs and next of kin of James Nibby in a wrongful death lawsuit. A settlement amount was not disclosed, but the family had been seeking $1 million in damages. After the tragedy that took Jim's life, his family channeled their grief into action. They introduced the James Nibby Outstanding Character Award Scholarship in his honor and launched an annual golf memorial event celebrating Jim's values and passions. But perhaps their most profound legacy was pushing for legislation aimed at helping families take control of their beloved's property from their killer's family. The murder of Jim Nibby left a void in the Nibby family, but through their endeavors, Jim's spirit became a beacon of hope, turning their sorrow into a legacy of positive change.